As you probably know, we use electric energy pretty much all the time during our daily life. We use it to create light, cook a meal, print documents, watch TV, and so on. That is why it is no wonder that the average electrical energy consumption is pretty high nowadays. I have the goal of lowering mine though. And what better way to do so than by being constantly exposed to my power consumption? Which will hopefully remind me that having one light on is enough. So in this video, I will show you how to use the ESP32 and some complementary components in order to create a proper power meter that can spit out pretty much all important power values. And at the end, I will then show you how to integrate this meter into my home assistant system, which I presented you in one of my previous videos. This way, I can see my power consumption at all times on my smartphone, which is handy and shocking at the same time. And with that being said, let's get started. This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, who currently offer a variety of promotions. Not only can you get 4-layer PCBs for a price of just $2, but you can also visit their virtual online exhibition, at which you have a 100% chance of winning prizes. So have a look for yourself. First off, how can we use a microcontroller in order to measure / calculate power? Well, before giving you a basic overview, I would recommend you to watch my basics video about true, reactive, apparent and deformed power, in order to get a true understanding of the subject. And with that being said, let's just simply get an old school light bulb and hook it up to the power grids while having a look at its current flow and its used voltage. As you can see, the voltage features the typical sinusoidal shape, with a top value of 326 volts, an RMS value of 231 volts, and a frequency of 50 Hz. So all normal values here in Germany. If we now observe the current, we can see that the waveform is also sinusoidal, and it follows the voltage waveform. That means our load is resistive, which means it is the simplest load that we can deal with. If we would hook up an inductive load like a motor, then the current waveform would be lagging. And if we would hook up a capacitive load, then the current waveform would be leading. And if we got the most difficult load to work with, like a laptop power supply, then the current can look something like this, with current spikes near the voltage peaks. Now you might be surprised, but it is actually not that difficult to calculate the real power of those four voltage and current waveforms. But let's start with the simplest one. The formula for calculating real power looks something like this, which might seem a bit scary, but by using the math function of my oscilloscope, I can partly visualize the formula on the screen. The newly shown waveform is the multiplication of the voltage and current values in each sampled point, and it represents the real power consumption over time. And if we would add up all of the area underneath this waveform, then we would get the average real power consumption. But let's make it a bit more difficult by having a look at an inductive load. As you can see, we still got mostly positive power values, but this time also some negative power values. Those values are not real power, since this power form only oscillates between the power source and load. So by subtracting this negative area from the positive one, we once again get the average real power we are looking for. Similar negative power areas appear for capacitive loads and also for our laptop charger loads. But you should now understand how to calculate the real power consumption of them as well. Now to sample the voltage and current with our microcontroller, we will need a safety transformer for the voltage and a current transformer for, obviously, the current. What the microcontroller will do is sample the current and voltage waveform a specified amount of times per half wave. Then it will multiply the values with one another, sum them up and divide them by the amount of samples. And just like that, we get an average real power measurement. Along the way, the microcontroller will also calculate the RMS voltage and RMS current, and use it to calculate the apparent power, and then finally the power factor. But if you want to learn more about those terms, then definitely have a look at the openenergymonitor.org website, which has tons of great information. And I will also be using the Ammonlib library in order to make programming easier for me. But anyway, with the theory out of the way, how exactly do we have to hook up the two transformers to the microcontroller? To find that out, I connected my safety transformer to mains voltage. But let me tell you that working with mains voltage can be lethal if not handled correctly. You have been warned. After then adding wire bridges to its output terminals, like it's shown on its label to get 12V AC, I hooked up my oscilloscope probes in order to find out that I was getting 39V peak to peak, which is of course way too high for my 3.3V microcontroller. To safely use it, we not only have to reduce the voltage, but also let it swing around an offset of, for example, half the supply voltage, so that the microcontroller can properly sample the waveform with its analog to digital converter. So what we need is basically this circuit. After adding all of the components to the microcontroller and the transformer, we can see how the voltage is now definitely suitable for our task. Which brings me to the current transformer. I got this one from eBay for pretty cheap, and it can handle a maximum current of 5 amps, and it comes with a ratio of 1000 to 1. That means, as soon as we pass a live wire through its core and power a load so that current flows through it, the created magnetic field of the primary side will create a current through the secondary side, which will be 1000 times lower. So at, for example, 5 amps, we would get a current flow of 5 milliamps, which will create a voltage drop of 1 volt, since the current transformer uses a burden resistor of 200 ohm. Now to make this 1V current signal suitable for the microcontroller, I will be using this simple circuit, which just adds an offset. After building it up, we can see on the oscilloscope that all values are now in the desired range. So it was time to hook up the voltage and current signal wires to pin 34 and 35 of the ESP32. For the software side, I already told you that I will be using an ESP32 version of the Ammonlib library. But what I haven't told you yet is that you should definitely browse through the included .cpp file in order to see some beautiful, well-explained math on how to calculate all the values. But anyway, after uploading the given example code and connecting my energy multimeter to the loads in order to check whether the calculated values are all correct, I noticed that pretty much nothing was correct yet. The problem was that the current and voltage calibration variables were not adjusted yet. But after fiddling around with them for quite a while, I reached a sweet spot. As you can see, we can measure pretty similar power values with my complicated laptop charger, but also with more high power loads like my toaster. Of course, there are accuracy differences between my 1000 euro energy meter and this 30 euro ESP32 meter, but overall I was rather impressed with this build. So, time to integrate it into my home assistant setup. But sadly, I quickly noticed that the Ammonlib library is not supported by ESP Home. That is why I browsed through the available tutorials in order to learn how to create a custom sensor. To do that, all I had to do was to upload the ammonlib.h and ammonlib.cpp file to the ESP Home folder, and then create a new .h file into which I more or less copied the example Arduino code. After then altering the code of my new ESP32 nodes, it compiled and uploaded without any problems. That means it was time for me to add all the power values to my overview boards. And as you can see, everything still seems to work just fine. Awesome! So, as a last step, I soldered my ESP32 to a perf board and added proper wiring to my complementary components in order to add them to my home distribution box for a test. And I'm only doing a test here because I currently do not have the space inside my home distribution box to permanently mount all of the components there. So I will have to come up with a solution for that in the future. But nevertheless, the power meter still works perfectly fine. And I hope you enjoyed watching this project. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative! And I will see you next time!